welcome to our final session of The Truth About Normal. It seems crazy that we've already gone through all 5 weeks, really taking a look at deconstructing our understanding of what the normal life of a Christ follower looks like. And we've been walking through, almost verse by verse, the Sermon on the Mount and using that as our guide as we have kind of journeyed this. So for those of you who are doing the homework, how did you do with week 4? It wasn't great, I told you. Like it wasn't my favorite either, but you did it. So after tonight's session, I'll kind of wrap up at the end and kind of tell you how to move forward in your final week of study. But as you have done this almost verse by verse, we've looked at a lot of hard things, and tonight we're going to wrap up, and we're actually going to skip ahead a little bit all the way to the end. And so as you go through the final week of study, you'll kind of back up. But tonight we're going to look at this idea of doing something in someone's name when you don't really know that person. You see, when I was in, I was in fifth grade, I was staying the night at my Aunt Donna's house, and many of you know her, and she had a friend that she was renting a space from, and I was watching the Grammys, and I was just all about this boy band that was on the stage. I was just, that was my world, okay? And Miss Linda walked through the living room and said, "Oh, that's little Justin Timberlake." And I went, "How do you know him? How do you know him?" And she proceeded to tell me that she was good friends with his grandparents and she used to babysit him. And she said, "In fact, if you would like to speak with his grandmother, I would love to call her right now." And little 11, 12-year-old me was like, "I can't breathe. Like, I cannot function." And before I knew it, here came Miss Linda with the phone, and she said, "Here, she would love to speak to you." And I had this whole conversation with this lady, and it was incredible. And she got my name and my address. And in the week that followed, she sent me little family snapshots of him and wrote me a letter. And you better believe the next day that I went to school, I was like, "I'm basically part of their family." Like, I don't know if you know this person, but like, I carried that as a memento. And I can tell you, every letter and every picture are safely tucked in a box in my mother's basement, because that is like impressive stuff, okay? But I immediately dropped his name into any conversation I could muster up for months that followed. I was insufferable when it came to that. And as much as I felt like I was in the inner circle, I wasn't, right? It was just a kind older woman who was, you know, dealing with my teenage angst or whatever it was. But all too often, we become very comfortable just knowing of someone. And I think that we need to adjust our perspective, because knowing of someone is not the same as knowing someone, and being associated with someone is not the same as being in relationship with someone. You see, we can't claim to speak or do things on someone's behalf if we do not know that person. You see, my man, he is my best friend. I love that man. And so I wouldn't hesitate to speak on his behalf and say, "Well, I know how Matt would handle this. I know," because we are in right relationship. We are in deep relationship. I would have no business looking at Deborah and saying, "I'm just going to go ahead and speak for Mr. Steve," right? I love Mr. Steve, but I don't know all the ins and outs of him, right? So we have to be mindful that we're not speaking and doing things in the name of someone that we are only associated with, and we don't actually know. And we're going to look at that through the lens of our relationship with Jesus. So turn with me to Matthew 7. We're going to read verse 21 and 22. It says this: "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works in your name?' And then I will declare to them, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness.'" Now, that passage, if we just dove right into it, can get really heavy really quickly. So we're going to take it in small sections. And I just want to start off by focusing on a very small word in the very first verse. It says, "Not everyone who says." Write down that word "says," or highlight it in your Bible or circle it. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord. Now that word is very interesting because the literal meaning of that word is to mention. To mention. And we mention things all the time, right? Good and bad. We like to name drop into conversations. We like to mention little comments just to throw our two cents in there. We mention our opinions in casual passing. We mention something that someone has forgotten to make our point. We mention things all the time. But you see, that's not the kind of relationship that Jesus wants of us. He doesn't want us to just mention his name when we are doing something in his church or for his people. And I love that he gives us something that we can compare it to. Turn over to Romans chapter 10, verse 13. It says this, "For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." You see, if you just take this verse at face value and you compare it to Matthew 7:21, it would be very easy to assume that the word says and the word calls are close to the same thing. And so how can these things contradict themselves? But the word in Matthew 7 means to mention, but this word calls, that word means to take on the name of someone. That word means to call out to Jehovah. Do you see the difference? There is a difference in just casually mentioning God's name and using it to accomplish the things that you want to accomplish or using it to make yourself look good and actually taking on his name as his child. Calling out to Jehovah, pursuing what he actually has for us. We are not called to merely mention and name drop his name into our lives, but we are supposed to live under the banner of his name. He is our safe place. He is where we go for wisdom and for direction. And I think it's very interesting that at the end of verse 21, it says, "Only the one who does the will of my Father." Now, that's a hefty line, right? Only the one who does the will of my Father. So in order to understand what the will of the Father is, we got to find that, right? Because if I just said, hey, what do you think the will of the Father is? We would get lots of opinions. And we need to go to the Word. So turn with me to John chapter 6, verse 40. It says, "For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day." I love in this verse that he directly ties doing the will of the Father with looking to the Son. God provides eternal life through Jesus, and our only responsibility is to look to him. And so if we are looking to him, if we want to know what doing the Father's will looks like, then we have to follow what Jesus did. And we have to do what Jesus did. And honestly, as I sat down to begin to make a list of what are the things that Jesus did, right? That's a hefty list to try to accomplish. And really, as I begin to make the list of the things that Jesus did, I thought that's not really the list we need to look at. And here's why. You may go, oh, that's not what you just taught. Here's why. If I say Jesus loved people, we believe the best of ourselves, don't we? And it's real easy to say, oh, I love people. Jesus served people. Oh, me too. I serve people. Jesus was patient with people. I'm patient-ish. Like, I'm doing pretty good, right? I don't want to look for our context at what Jesus did. I want to look at what Jesus did not do. Because I think that forces us to look at the things that we are doing actively in our lives and the separation that creates in us actually doing the Father's will and leaving that out. So let's talk about that. Jesus did not make it about himself. Every single opportunity that Jesus had to make it about himself. Because honestly, when you read some of the stuff that Jesus accomplished, I kind of want to go, hey, you did great. that was great. And every single time he said, oh, no. I came to do the will of my Father. He pointed people back to the Father. He gave glory to the Father. Jesus never made it about himself. Jesus did not twist scripture to fit his own narrative. Jesus did not excuse sin. Jesus did not make light of relational dysfunction. Jesus did not celebrate division. He inserted himself in the middle of it, and he spoke truth. And he spoke the truth of the Father. And he sought to bring about reconciliation and healing. Jesus did not speak poorly of other people. Jesus had a very tight-knit group of men that were around him, and he did not use those relationships as excuses to talk poorly about other people under the guise of, I just need to vent. Has anybody just vented before? Doesn't it just feel good? I heard something this week online. It says, you don't need to vent because vents go into other rooms. And I was like, whoo. Vents go into other rooms. I thought, oh, goodness. Jesus didn't use his relational proximity to people to vent. He didn't speak poorly about others. He did not take advantage of position or power. He did not consider others beneath him, no matter how messy they were, no matter how forgotten they were, no matter how deep in sin they were, no matter how lost they were, he did not consider anyone beneath him. He did not stay silent on social issues. If you read scripture, you see that a lot of the things that he said were radical at the time. People would have heard him speak. We talked about early in the study how the things that he was teaching in the Beatitudes would have just really caused people to stop and go, what did you just say? He spoke up on social issues. Jesus did not speak or lead from anger. Jesus did not allow his emotions to dictate what he did. His emotions did not derail him from the purpose of the Father. Jesus did not play at his faith. Jesus did not turn his commitment to the Father off and on when it suited him or when he was tired or when he was at a season where he had just poured out and poured out and poured out and served. He didn't say, okay, that's enough. I'm just going to turn this whole belief thing off and just sit for a second. His commitment to the Father never wavered. Jesus didn't compromise on anything. So, here's what I can tell you. Sometimes I make it about myself. Sometimes I can excuse sin. Sometimes I can make light of relational dysfunction because I can explain it. Sometimes I speak poorly about people. Sometimes I can stay silent on social issues. Sometimes I can speak or lead or make decisions from a place of anger or emotional distress. Sometimes I can play at my faith, and sometimes I compromise. Does that list resonate with anybody? You see, if any of these things on this list are defining qualities of your life, you are not doing the Father's will. Full stop. And you may say, well, I'm not talking about people all the time. I only talk about people with just this one person. Okay, well, good. You're doing better than most. But that one relationship is not honoring God. And y'all, Satan will use anything he can to get a foothold in the door of our lives and take our attention off the Father. Normal says you can have one foot in your faith and one foot out of your faith, and you can just lean on the understanding of we're just all sinners saved by grace. Give me a break. Jesus did not sacrifice himself so that we could just be kind of better versions of us, right? He came to fully save us. And a lot of the things that we're compromising on and a lot of the things that we are choosing are not reflective of our Savior. And so if Scripture tells us that if we are to do the Father's will, we have to look to the Son, then we have to make sure that we are setting the example for who Jesus actually is. We have to make sure that we are continually giving glory to the Father. And if any of these things resonate with you and if any of these things are defining characteristics of different portions of your life, here's your chance to change it. Correct it and move forward. Acknowledge it, own it, give it to God, and move forward. That's repentance. No one is getting this 100% right, right? It's okay. It's okay to say that we struggle. So let's keep going. And I love as he transitions out of this portion of scripture talking about not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. I love that as he's closing out the sermon, because we're just a few verses from the end of it, that he has taken us from looking at relational issues. He has taken us from looking at acts of righteousness, living out our faith, the things that we say, the things that we do. And he says, this is exactly what the life of a believer is supposed to look like. He is reaffirming the fact that you can't just know, say, and do the right things and be good. You have to be in right relationship with me. So he takes it from the very beginning and he says, this is not going to look the way you thought it was going to look. And he goes through every little detailed issue that we could have in our lives. And at the very end, he says, again, because it says, on that day, many will say, did we not prophesy in your name? Did we not cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works? He says, you can do all the right things. You can do all the church things. It can look really good. And if I didn't know you, none of those other things matter. You see, a life imitating a believer is a life promoting faith while never surrendering to it. A life imitating a believer is a life of promoting faith and never surrendering to it. You can know a lot of things up here. And you can say the right things and you can carry yourself the right way and you can make it look good. But if you don't ever surrender to your belief in Jesus, if you don't ever surrender to him, if you don't ever completely allow him to be in control of your life, you are an imitation. He calls us to something deeper. And honestly, this is something that is between you and God. No one else gets to know or decide where you sit with this. But you know the areas of your life you're just pretending in. You know the areas of your life you haven't fully given to Jesus. You know that thing, that struggle, that turmoil that is just constantly there, that you haven't allowed the gospel to really change in you. And he says, let's go beyond that. Let's not do the normal version of this. Let's go deeper. Surrender it all to me. You can know all the right things about God. You can quote scripture. You can do all the serving in your church. You can be the person that everybody comes to. You can imitate what you think a believer should look like. But one of my favorite verses, it's kind of a weird verse to be a favorite verse, is James 2:19. And it says, you believe there is one God? Good, even the demons believe that and they shudder. So understand that if the basis of everything, if all you've got is a belief that there is one God, you're not doing any better than the demons of hell. He says they recognize that there's one God and they shudder. It scares them to death. We have to go further. As Christ followers, as believers, our lives should look different than just saying and doing the right things. Are you in relationship? Are you in right relationship with the Father? I don't want us to be a group of women just doing and acknowledging the bare minimum of our faith. That's not what we're here for. Normal is not and never has been the goal. So the question is not, do you know Jesus? Not in this area, maybe for somebody watching online, maybe the question does need to be said, do you know Jesus? But for the women in this room right now, I believe that the question is, have you surrendered your life to Jesus? Not just the parts that you're comfortable with, but the messy parts, the ugly parts, the trauma parts, the parts that nobody knows about, the parts that keep you up at night, the parts that you're still angry over. Have you surrendered those parts to Jesus? Have you entrusted those to him? Because that is true salvation. That is where Jesus desires to meet us. And all too often, we get caught up in just doing what we have come to expect of ourselves, doing what we have come to expect of what our faith walk looks like. And what's actually happening is we are giving a God acknowledgement in something, but we are not giving him control. And it's more about building our own kingdom than it is about building his. We're doing what we want, how we want it, and we're doing it in his name, and we're not actually surrendering anything to him because we're trying to build our own kingdom, our own perception of what our ministry and our faith and our journey should look like. We don't ever pause and try to figure out, God, is this what you have for me right now? Is this what you're really calling me to right now? We leave no space for him because we've already decided what we want to do, so we just do it, but we do it in his name, so that makes it okay, right? He literally says, people are going to look at me and say, did I not do all the things that your word called me to do in your name? And he says, I will look at you and say, I never knew you. Depart from me. That's a harsh statement. And it's a hard conversation to have. But we will not shy away from hard statements in Scripture because that's where we lean in and that's where we have to step out of the humanness of us and we have to lean into the Father and we have to recognize that this is not a game. This is not something that we are playing at. We can't just acknowledge him and not put him at the center of it because here's what I know. People, women, have plenty of experience with sleazy, self-centered, nose in the air, my way or the highway people in church, yeah? People have plenty of experience with those kind of people. Church hurt is a real thing. You have a lot of people who are weaponizing leadership. There are a lot of people that distort the gospel. We don't want our names added to that list, do we? You don't want your name on that list. People are looking for authentic women of faith, men of faith who are looking to build God's kingdom and not their own, who are looking to surrender their lives fully to him, knowing that he's in control. We are never in control. We may have the perception of control. You are never in control. You may think you have a handle on all the things that you haven't surrendered to him. You don't. I don't know a whole lot, but I do know that. Because here's what's awful. I don't either. Isn't that terrible? We have control over nothing. It's his anyway. But when we surrender it to him, we have this beautiful interaction with the Father where we entrust him with something that he's the only one that can do anything about it. And we take our hands off it and we give something to him that's already his. Let me tell you, if one of y'all had something of mine, of value, I'd be nice the first couple times. Like, hey, don't forget to return that. Hey, you, how's that going? And then I'd be like, all right, here's the deal. I'm gonna need that back. But the Father, in his patience and love for us, he creates space for us because we're not robots. He allows us to choose him. And he allows us to choose relationship with him. He allows us to surrender things to him. But make no mistake, nothing that you have, good or bad, belongs to you. It's all his. And there's beauty in surrendering it to him. So as we move into literally the last two verses of the Sermon on the Mount, we move down to Matthew 7, 28 through 29. Now that portion of 24 through 27, that's what you're going to close out your week this week on week five of the homework. You're going to look at the house built on the rock and the comparison between the two men. And I love that passage. But to close out, we're going to kind of skip over it quickly and look at how this sermon closes. It says, when Jesus finished these sayings, the crowds were astonished at his teaching, for he was teaching them as one who had authority and not as one of their scribes. Can you imagine sitting on this mountainside and you've just heard Jesus speak all of these things that we've walked through over the last 5 weeks and you've heard it in person, real life, and you're clinging to every word because remember, they didn't have a copy of it, right? You're clinging to every word that this man is saying, and then you're just sitting there left to process what you've received from him. And I want you to note what they did. They immediately compared him to all their other teachers. They immediately said that they were astonished at his teaching because he was teaching them as somebody who had authority, not like their teachers. He was approaching this from a different way. And that phrase, speaking as one who has authority, literally means that he was not only saying the right things, but he was also living them. They recognized him as authentic and real. They recognized that he was not asking them to do something that he was not already doing himself. He was not asking them to surrender their lives to the Father where he held close to his. He was not asking them to give glory to the Father while he brought glory to himself. He said, "This is what I'm doing to honor the Father. Follow my example." They had never encountered any teacher like that. So if you know the real Jesus, then you know that when you compare him to everything and everyone else, you know he's different. You know it's not the same. You know that he is who he says he is. And you know that if the Father has commanded us to look to the Son in order to live out his will, then we have to be willing to be different and to be set apart and to be authentic and to be real. That is the call on our lives. And today, honestly, is a really great day to start doing that. Because you've come to the end of this study, you've come to almost the end of this portion of Scripture, and we've seen in great detail Jesus line out exactly who we are supposed to be, not in ourselves, but in him. But unfortunately, in order to do that, what I know is true about myself, and I'm just going to go ahead and project that onto all of you ladies, there are things that are going to be painful that we're going to have to let go. And there are habits, and there are situations, and there are relationships, and there are emotions, and there are just things that are going to be painful to let go of. There are going to be cycles of normal that we're going to have to break in our own lives. Because what happens is when we're willing to break that cycle and you're trading in this counterfeit version of Christianity that you have been experiencing, you're trading it in for an authentic relationship with Jesus. And that's better than anything. That's the only thing that we should ever want or value. And unfortunately, if you've been doing life with other people, maybe even other believers, your family, your friends, your spouse, your coworkers, the people that you go to church with, they may have come to expect a normal version of you. And isn't it so sad how it is very common for a few people in church to get on fire for the Lord and others in the church to go, "What are you doing? That's weird. That's sad." People in your life may have come to expect a normal version of you, but we're not doing that anymore. We're not pursuing that anymore. We are living for Jesus, we are living through Jesus, and we are living with Jesus. That's the only way we are ever going to be able to accomplish all the things that he has laid out for us in the Sermon on the Mount. But again, it's going to hurt. We're not going to have like a magic prayer time where we say amen and we all go, "We did it. We fixed it." You're going to walk out of this room and you're going to go to the same car that brought you. And you're going to go to the same house that has the same struggles and the same issues with the same bank account and the same job and the same kids and the same relational struggles and the same trauma and the same emotions. So you have to choose what you're going to do with it. Are you going to continue to do what you've always done? Or are you going to trade that in for an authentic interaction with the Savior? Are you going to believe that he is who he says he is? Are you going to stop mentioning him when it is convenient for you? Are you going to stop engaging with him when it serves you? And are you actually going to call out on the Father and live under the banner of his name, and literally live in the shadow of who Jesus is? Are you more concerned with people meeting Jesus than people meeting you? Do you want people to meet Jesus more than you want people to meet your opinions? Do you want people to meet Jesus more than you want people to meet your political standing? Do you want people to meet Jesus more than you want them to encounter what you believe to be true about a certain situation? Because if you lead and you have a more passionate desire for them to know where you stand than you have for them to know who Jesus is, you need to stop. It is the scariest thing in the world to think that Jesus acknowledges in Scripture that there are people who know the Father, who do work on behalf of the Father, and are not in relationship. And we'll hear the phrase, "Depart from me, I would never knew you." And he does a little bit of name calling, y'all. "You workers of lawlessness." It's scary. It's heavy. I don't want that. I don't want to hear that. I want to hear, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." I want you to hear, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." But we got to take our hands off the things that we're holding on. We have to let go of the counterfeit version that we have been living, and it's hard. But I love that Scripture speaks to that too. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 10 and 11 says, "For godly grief produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret, whereas worldly grief produces death. For see what earnestness this godly grief has produced in you, but also what eagerness to clear yourselves, what indignation, what fear, what longing, what zeal, what punishment. At every point you have proved yourself innocent in the matter." You see, when God is calling attention to something in your life, it produces repentance that leads to salvation without regret. But when the world tries to take from us, that's all it does. It just takes. It says it produces death. But this fear, this grief that we may experience of letting go some old habits, letting go of some past traumas, letting go of some things that we have been tending to and taking care of, being mindful of our hurts and our emotions, letting go of those things may be hard, but it's going to produce something in you that furthers your salvation with Jesus. It doesn't lead to death. The end is not the end. It leads you closer to Jesus. And it's this beautiful cycle. Some of you, maybe you came into this study with a death grip on a hope or a want or a desire or a frustration. And maybe that's the very thing that Jesus is looking at you and saying, "It's not yours. As a matter of fact, you're mine. And you are so consumed with what you want and what you perceive to be right that you are missing me entirely." Maybe we are clinging to things because it suits us and it serves us, and we are applying His name to it. And we're saying, "Well, God told me to," or "God led me." We have to be so careful that we are not speaking for someone that we do not know and that we are not in right relationship with and who we have not sought after. How dare we position ourselves to speak of our Father when we have not surrendered our lives to Him? How dare we? But in the way that Scripture always does, it points us back to a promise of salvation. It points us back to Jesus. It says, deal with it, go through it, experience the loss, but it's going to lead you deeper with me. And so as we look at the final portion of Matthew chapter 7, and we kind of close the door on the Sermon of the Mount, I don't know how your Bible titles that last section, but mine says "The Authority of Jesus." That's the title over those last two verses, "The Authority of Jesus." And I love it because at the end of like a long letter to somebody, what do? We sign our name, right? We want to know this. I want you to know this was from me, right? And I love that at the end of this sermon, the title head, "The Authority of Jesus," is where it leaves us. It doesn't say, do you have any suggestions on anything that I just said? Would you like to rate the sermon 1 to 5 stars? Did you discuss this between church and the Mexican restaurant? And how did that fall for everybody? Doesn't say any of that. It says the authority of Jesus. He speaks like no one else speaks. He hears us like no one else hears us. He lives what he teaches. He loves the Father more than anything. And he completely surrenders his life for the Father. And he calls us to do the same. So as we close our study of the Sermon on the Mount, the question has to be asked again, are you living the life of a surrendered Christ follower? Or are you maintaining a level of normal in your life that is comfortable and that is convenient? Are you believing that God has more for you than what the world is offering us? Do you believe that even when it feels like loss, it's not, because he takes what we don't have and he turns it into something that we could never imagine? Do you know Jesus? Do you know that when we read in the Old Testament the excitement of God's people for the coming Messiah should mirror our excitement, because he's coming back? And so while we have a complete scripture, we have a complete Bible, there is more to come. Isn't that great? Isn't that incredible? Do you know that, Jesus? Do you know that there is no loss or hurt or pain that you are experiencing right now that heaven is not going to heal? Do you know that as a Christ follower, even though you may feel you are lacking in nothing? Do you know that you are chosen and you are forgiven and you are redeemed? Normal doesn't look like that in this world. But that's not what we're doing. And so as you spend some time in small groups as our final kind of wrap-up discussion for this study, and as you go throughout your week and you finish the last 3 days of homework, would you just ask that God would soften your heart to the areas that he needs to correct? Would you ask that God would let you take your hands off of things that you have been holding in your own control? And would we all move forward in agreement that we are not just going to mention his name in our lives, but we are going to claim him as our Father, and we are going to come under the banner of his name, and we are going to live like his people, and we are going to represent him well? Because he has rescued us completely. He has saved us completely. That's the challenge. So as I pray, you guys are going to break into small groups, 3, 4, 5. I don't care. Do 10 or 12. Whatever you want to do. It's the last night. I'm not going to correct you. But you've got a couple of questions that will come up on the screen. You guys discuss those. And when you are finished, you are dismissed. Thank you so much for coming along this with me for the last 5 weeks. It's been a real joy to lead you through this. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for our time together. And Father, thank you for being a God that we can call on. Thank you for being a God that desires for us to not just mention your name, but to claim your name, to call on you. Because God, you desire to have a relationship with us. God, you desire to know us. Father, please correct us in the ways that we are choosing to live outside of who you are. God, correct us in the times that we are putting your name on something where it doesn't belong. Father, correct our hearts when we are more concerned about getting what we want than having a deeper relationship with you. God, would you let us see that while we can do and say all the right things, that you want to see us love you and pursue you and obey you. And so, God, I pray that as we continue to pore over this Sermon on the Mount, and I pray that we come back to it time and time again and see the truth of the life of a believer, God, I pray that you would continually, day by day, realign our lives to mirror what you have called us to. Father, we love you. It is in your son's name we pray. Amen.